Borderlands is the name of a franchise heard by many, and it emits thoughts of maniacal CEOs bent on the destruction of the planet you stand on, an 18-year-old robot whiz breaking the game to an ungodly state, an angry Truxican with a stunted growth dual-wielding assault rifles, and of course 14-year-old demolitions experts. It holds a place in many people's hearts, whether it be for the humor, gameplay, or genuine feeling of badassery when you solo a boss designed with the intention of having friends join in on the fun. It's a colorful, varied experience with so many fun missions and moments of hilarity that it's hard to forget. However, all these moments I've mentioned come mostly from the sequel, Borderlands 2. I remember the day I finally thought to myself, hey, I'm playing a sequel, so there has to be a first game too, right? And the answer to that is yes. And to save you some time in case you've got better things to do, Borderlands is pretty good as a foundation for what would later come. The original Borderlands recently got remastered, and anyone who owned any edition of the game on Steam got it completely for free, me included. So I hopped back onto Pandora and experienced it again for the first time in what has to be 2 or 3 years. I never played Borderlands during its initial release window. In 2009, I was still hooked on my Wii and only had a crummy laptop as an alternative for other games outside of that. But when I did buy Borderlands at a steep discounted price, I remember my experience being underwhelming. The classes weren't as interesting to me, being very bare bones and basic, but I did think it was cool that these were the characters that I met progressively in the sequel, which put a lot of things into perspective. I remember the game feeling tedious, repetitive, confusing, and overall unsatisfying given my expectations were pretty high after playing the successor it would spawn 3 years later. Regardless of all of this, however, I was excited to step off that bus again and behold what waited once again in a new light, with a mini-map this time! So let's jump into that. Pretty quickly, let me say, the story of Borderlands is short. It pretty much boils down to, you're a vault hunter, and you are hunting for a vault. That's it. Some other stuff happens too, I guess, but for the most part, some of it never really feels realized, and a part of that comes from some of the characters. There's a lot of hype around Patricia Tanis, it would seem, on the offset. Her origins, how she's getting supplies, how she knows what she knows, but whoops! Looks like I dropped the ball there. It never actually comes full circle. She's built up to be what I only assumed would be a major story component, but after you get the info you need from her, it's like everyone just forgets she even exists. She's rarely brought up again, and it's a shame because I feel like she was set up to be a major story component, only to be dropped once she's no longer useful. She has some audio logs explaining a bit of her backstory, and to date, we still don't know much about her, but a few Easter eggs from Gearbox's latest shit show, not that one, points to maybe she'll finally get the treatment that she deserves. A few other characters that fall into this category is Commander Steel and Helena Pierce, to an extent. Commander Steel is the final boss of the game, but I honestly don't know jack fucking shit about her. She only ever talks to you a few times during the game, and every time it's just to say, "Hey, you! Quit that, stop it!" Only to fade back into obscurity every time, and then all of a sudden, decides to try and backtrack and become important near the end. Helena Pierce is only ever found in New Haven, and she's in a few of the trailers, and that heavily implies that her involvement would be of a great importance. Nope. Another character that just kinda drops away much more heavily than the others, I gotta say. Now, Borderlands is a series that's only got 3 main entries so far, but it has a lot of lore. And lore isn't the same as a story. You see, lore builds the world around you, things maybe you didn't experience firsthand. You're only playing a small part of that lore in that story, in that world. An individual story. And nothing builds that better than Marcus the Arms Dealer. He delivers you to your starting point on Pandora and narrates the opening intro. He also later opens up shops in the towns and locations you visit. He's partly the reason I was led to believe that Tanis might be a bigger part in the game, but on top of that, he's simply one of my favorite fucking characters in all of the franchise. His voice gives me chills. I love hearing his narration. But again, he opens plot holes that he never closes. Then there's Claptrap, one of the first characters you meet after stepping off that bus. He's a Hyperion CL4P TP model steward bot that provides missions, reminders, and some annoyingly frustrating help throughout your trek on Pandora. Of course, there's the player characters Lilith, Mordecai, Roland, and Brick. They're referred to affectionately as the Vault Hunters. In Borderlands, they had little personality and only a few defining characteristics. In the later games, they are much better, but I'm not talking about those other games. I'm talking about one, the first one. The series would continue venturing forth into building characters away from the nameless protagonist type game that the initial entry kind of had. They all had default names, sure, but mostly they were blank slates if you didn't attempt to learn more about them. And trust me, they're all great characters, but we can't lose focus that in Borderlands they were just kind of blank. There are other characters I love, of course, the blind TK Baja, Scooter the Mechanic, but if I spent all day talking about every character I liked, I'd be here all day because Borderlands is just full of them. These were just some of the characters that play a big role in the game. You kill a lot of shit, take some pieces of a key, and open a vault. That's it. The first Borderlands had a very simple plot. That's partly what makes it so charmingly underwhelming. There's not a lot going on at any given time. You're progressing, moving forward all the time, helping characters along the way, sort of building a foundation for yourself and opening up resources that you'll probably need later, and that's pretty neat. But outside of the starting area around Firestone feeling like a sluggish, tedious tutorial, and everywhere past that feeling like a story that's introducing more elements than it can follow up on, it's not really a story-driven game. And considering the Vault Hunters are painted as sort of there for their own reasons and drives rather than to help the people, it feels kind of fitting to have such a structure. Vault Hunters are typically painted as kind of selfish people out for profit, guns, and women. Sure, later they'd be given a more caring and concerned personality, but that's only after some stuff we never actually see. They've grown as people by the time the sequel comes along, and that's fine. Most people might want to imagine their character did this or that after they opened that big hole in the ground. Story wasn't important for Borderlands in its introduction, but it became a bigger focus later in the sequels, which had tons of world building and interaction, and that's fine. But in Borderlands 1, the story has the same charm the Doom reboot holds. You don't have to care too much about why or how you're doing the stuff you're doing, and that's also fine because the story is not like the Doom story, and it's very underwhelming and incomplete feeling in a way. But people don't remember Borderlands for its story, that much is clear. What people more than likely remember Borderlands for is the iconic gameplay that defined a new genre with its inception, the looter shooter. There are several different weapon types which can all spawn with different parts and manufacturers, loads of different grenade mods, shields, class mods, all with tiny varying differences that brings us to the main selling point of Borderlands, its potential for billions, zillions of gun combos and gear matchups. Everything about a weapon can change small things for it. Does it fire bullets or grenade shots? What about a shotgun that fires rockets instead? That's groovy, man. A gun that lets you deal more melee damage? I'm fucking sold. Borderlands is a game franchise that never truly gets boring on a surface level if you think about it. How much you have to do. You can use so many different combos to help you overcome so many obstacles by just trying a different setup than you would normally run. The core gunplay and strategizing is what makes it fun, but it has an ugly cousin in the form of quests. I'm talking side quests specifically. The side quests in Borderlands feel tedious, annoying, and it's like a chore to do them. They're so bland, a lot of it is go here, fight thing, pick up thing, come back. Again, the sequel had a lot of the same quest types, but they were filled with much more humor and thought into them to make them fun to do and to see the reactions. Here, there is virtually none of that, and there's so fucking many of them. I was around level 20 and had complete all of the mission's main and side quests at my disposal before even moving on to the second main area of the game, where you'll finally move on to New Haven, a bustling, more lively town than that of Firestone, which is empty and abandoned. And you know what? I was still just barely a high enough level to comfortably proceed, and that's what I'd consider a big drawback for the game. The main quests don't scale to the level you're at, meaning you have to do a sort of grind to get a comfortable level through the side quests. And again, there are so many of them. Look, I know I already said that, but just holy hell, look at this list. It wasn't until I was around level 30 or so that I decided to just start skipping some and take my chances. And I was still able to beat the final boss pretty well, but that's partly because I'm playing a slightly overpowered character. Now, needing side quests to stay leveled with the game's difficulty curve is something that's present in a few other games I like. Fallout games to an extent, even though those are entirely open world, many high level areas you're gonna have to grind to stand a chance in, and a few other RPGs do it. And it's a fine concept, but would it have killed Gearbox to tweak these quests in the remaster, maybe collapse them into bigger quests for bigger bonuses? So many side quests exist just to introduce you to characters. The talk to blank is the only objective in a lot of them. There are at least three of these hidden journals quests, which I feel could have been made into a big quest that you do in the background over the course of the whole game, just lumping a big XP bonus when you finish the total of all three quests, but collapsed into one. Some of them are like the same quest, but broken into different parts, which I'm mostly fine with those. That way you don't have to do every part in the quest line if you don't want to. But they're so short anyway that you might as well just do all of them. Side questing is tedious in Borderlands, but it's so necessary to play comfortably. A few simple tweaks would have fixed it in the remaster, and I don't think any of what I've said about it is particularly new or controversial, but hey, at least I got a mini-map. I'm putting a spoiler alert here, skip to this time if you don't want to hear about the final boss. The Destroyer is one of gaming's most notoriously awful boss fights. Yeah, the Destroyer is a complete pushover, and all the build-up to the vault, the broken story, the people you've had to kill to get here, and then the introduction of the Destroyer by offing Commander Steel is kind of a testament to what false advertising looks like. The thing in the original game kinda just sits there and whacks at you a little bit, and the remaster, it's the same thing with a couple new moves, I guess. I don't know, it wasn't all that memorable in the first game, and it's not all that memorable in the second game. And considering a lot of the game is kind of unmemorable, it's not very surprising. You may have noticed that despite my best efforts, I can't stop referring to the sequel, Borderlands 2. It's a game with one of the most active communities on YouTube, Reddit, anywhere really. So many people discuss it, play it together, uncover secrets about it, and there's a whole mod devoted to making it fresh again, which I recently played through. Borderlands 2 holds such a special place in my heart. It was the first one I played in the franchise with a good friend of mine after he convinced me to buy it, and playing the first one all those years ago, and again just recently, I can definitely say, this is Borderlands, but it's not the game I think of when I think of Borderlands. It has all the right pieces, gunplay, questing, skill trees, but everything is so improved upon in later installments, and the crazy factor is just taken up like three whole notches. Borderlands 1 is a foundation for a masterpiece. It's the ground the series would build on to make a name for itself, and we have Borderlands to thank for that, and paying a visit to it every now and again isn't a horrible thing to do, to remember that things only go up from here in the following installments. Borderlands 1 has a newfound respect in my heart, but overall I'd say if you're new to the franchise, just go straight to the sequel. You won't have missed too much.